to another Apollo Papyrus episode. I am Aaron Apollo Camp. For this episode, my interview guest is the author of the fantasy novel Obsidian Tide, which will be part of a four-book series titled The Lumos Gems Chronicles. In addition to her work as an author, she is also a software engineer and a fantasy board game enthusiast. Her name is Joanna McSpadden, and here's my interview with Joanna. Joanna McSpadden, welcome to Apollo Papyrus.
Hello, thank you for having me.
Feel free to introduce yourself to our listeners.
Yeah, of course. So I'm a software developer by day and a high fantasy writer by night. So I've always been a big bibliophile and avid fantasy board game enthusiast. So games like Gloomhaven, Frosthaven, D&D, you name it, that's my thing. And when I am writing, I really want to inspire readers to dream and embrace their authenticity and to go after, you know, whatever it is they desire, even if it goes against what society says they should do or the status quo.
Without spoiling too much of your fantasy novel, Obsidian Tide, what is your first book about?
Yeah, so Obsidian Tide is about a trio that gets hit with a deadly disease. So the emperor of the land gets hit with this disease, and so does one of the characters, and they have to go out and find a cure for this deadly disease that seemingly has no cure. So it's a very magical adventure teeming with different foes. Like, there's some dragons, there's some other creatures that are new to this world. So it's very much a, you know, quest and ancient magical and ancient relics.
Obsidian Tide will be part of a planned four-book series titled The Lumos Gems Chronicles. Without spoiling too much about the entire series, will there be an overarching theme to the series? And if so, what will it be?
Yeah, so really the overarching theme, like deeper meaning, is to really, you know, go out and embrace who you are and trying to figure out who that is, even if it kind of changes throughout your life. So, I mean, story-wise, they're going out to find all of these Lumos gems. So one of them happens to be the Healing Stone in the first book. And then there's three others. So the books are really about collecting those. And then at a deeper meaning, really finding out who you are and going after what you're meant to do and your destiny.
Did your interest in fantasy board games draw you to write fantasy novels, or was it something else?
So I think it was very much board games, but I think my love for fantasy started much earlier. So growing up, I was very quiet, introverted. I loved escaping to fantasy worlds early on. So middle school, I loved the Prydain Chronicles by Lloyd Alexander and Harry Potter. And I think that's really where my love of fantasy started. And being a writer and being a board game enthusiast, I think, is just kind of on that same track. So it kind of all came at the same time, I guess.
Is Obsidian Tide self-published, traditionally published, or published via hybrid press? And what was your path to publishing Obsidian Tide like?
Yeah, great question. I actually went with a hybrid publisher, and there's not very many of those. So you do have to, you know, do your research and make sure that if you're going hybrid, that it truly is hybrid and not a vanity press. So my personal path to publishing was I was working with a writing coach at the time, and we were actually working on a query letter for me to start approaching agents. And going through that process, we ended up submitting it to this small publisher, Morgan James. And they accepted my manuscript before I even really started querying. And that was super exciting to know that I could actually get my book out there within, you know, 18 months versus, you know, having to query for years and then maybe trying to pitch my book for years after that. And then even if I got a publishing deal with a traditional publisher, it could still be, a while before I'd see it on the shelf. So I got really excited about doing this hybrid path. And so I worked with Morgan James directly, and they took me through the cover design, interior design, all of that fun stuff. They are helping with some of the marketing and getting it in the bookstores. So yeah, it's been a journey, but it's been really fast in terms of publishing in the publishing world.
What is your writing process like?
Yeah, great question again. I've changed a lot over the course of the past, I guess, 4 years. So my process now is to do I'm an extensive outliner. I know a lot of people like to just kind of go for it, but and take it as the story comes to them. But I like to really do an extensive outlining process where I figure out the main plot points and then how to get from each one to the next one. And then I kind of do a draft zero where I write out like all the action, all the like things that need to be in each chapter. So this to me helps with eliminating some of the rewrite that you could end up with. Like if you are on chapter five and you realize, oh, I didn't mention, this important thing, and I should have mentioned it earlier. If I'm in this draft zero, I can just put another bullet point in chapter three to mention it. So that's kind of a draft zero, I would say. And then I just do a full first draft, just kind of a writing dump of the story. So it's really just telling myself the story at this point. And I try not to get bogged down by any of the details that can come later in editing. So once I have the first draft, I like to let it rest for a couple of weeks. And then I'll come back, I'll read it all, I'll make a bunch of notes. Likely there's going to be things that I need to research or things I need to think about, some plot holes that I need to figure out how to fix. And so then I'll go into the revision phase with all of those questions, do a brainstorming phase, right? Answer all those questions, fix all those plot holes, figure out all those details that I was missing before, and then do another draft, with all of those things figured out. And then after that, I like to go back a couple more times of the manuscript and do some more character detail stuff. So like, what are they wearing? Is this the in their voice? Because I have multiple POVs, so I like to make sure that it sounds like the character that should be sounding like. And then I do more of a scene by scene look, making sure that everything is, tightened up, looking good. And then at that point, I like to send it to some readers. So I have some alpha readers that I'll send it to that I work with really closely, and they'll give me some feedback. I'll fix it. Then I'll send to beta readers, and then I'll get even more feedback. And then after all of that, then it actually goes to an editor. So it's a very long process. You wouldn't necessarily think it could take so long. Like you have the idea and you have it written, but the first draft is really not even the tip of the iceberg, in my writing process. So yeah, long process, but that's kind of, yeah, the whole thing.
Your writing process is a lot like mine,
Great.
is for fiction. Now, because I'm writing both fiction and nonfiction, my nonfiction writing process is totally different. I wrote one fiction
Yeah.
book back in 2019, that I did not do any outlining or anything of that sort in it, and it didn't work well. Let's just put it that way.
Yeah. Did you get like stuck with the story?
I just kind of winged it,
Yeah.
kind of wrote it without really get any thought of what I was doing, which is not the thing to do when
Gotcha.
writing books.
It is fun.
And also, you mentioned Obsidian Tide having multiple points of view. How do you handle going from one point of view to another in the same book in such a way that it doesn't confuse your readers?
So I have two very distinct POVs. One is my male main character, and one is a female main character. So I really try to ground the reader in, and it's also third person, so it is a little bit easier for me to be like, oh, Katarina said this, or Katarina's looking at this, or Liam feels like this. So that's a way to ground my readers when it's because it is third person. But I do also like to make sure that the voice is very distinct for each character. So you can kind of feel the difference between Liam chapters and Katarina chapters. So, I mean, I really try to bring each character's particular voice to life in that way.
Now, what happens to me sometimes in my writing process, and this will get me off track very quickly. Sometimes a new idea will come up when I'm working on a book. What do you do when a new idea comes to you while you're working on a book?
Yeah, this happens all the time to us creatives. I've been so tempted, especially lately, to just dabble in that new idea, but I have been very disciplined, and I have like a vault of ideas that I keep on my phone that just I can put it there. I know that I won't lose it. And then if I do have more ideas around a specific story idea, I can just jot it down in this vault and just leave it there. So I'm not losing anything that I've thought about, but I'm also not focusing on it right now. Because yes, like you said, you can get so distracted, go from one thing to the other, and then end up not making progress on the book you're trying to write. So I do try to, leave ideas in a different place.
Now, you mentioned that you tend to be very introverted, and how is being an
Yes.
introvert an advantage, a disadvantage, or both for you as an author?
Yeah. So the writing process itself lends very well to introverts. It's kind of an isolated activity. But the challenge does come when it's time to market the book. And I think that it is a little more uncomfortable for us introverts to put ourselves out there and to do interviews like this and to put ourselves out on social media constantly, trying to connect with our audience. And even though it is a challenge, I think that us introverts, we do have a different power in that way. Because we like to observe and we like to kind of take it all in. And I think that that gives us a lot more insight to what our audience is wanting and craving. So I think that in that way, we do have an advantage in being more observant, being more insightful, maybe connecting at a deeper level than some extroverts would. Everyone does it differently, and I'm not saying there's anything wrong with the way extroverts go about their marketing. I've seen, great connection from extroverts as well. But yeah.
What is the best advice you have for all people who are aspiring to be an author and are looking to write their first book?
So my best advice would be to not give up. And it's really tempting to give up. So I was in Adrienne Young's Writing with the Soul course in November. And one of the things that she really said that hit home was it's not necessarily the authors that are the best that end up being successful. It's the ones that don't quit. And I think that that's really true. It's really hard to write a book to begin with. It's really hard to let other people read it. And then it's really hard to get people to buy it as well. And you really have to stick with it, know that this is what you are meant to do and just keep going.
I have one final question, and it is about your day job. What is your work as a software developer like?
Yeah, it is pretty crazy. So I work on e-commerce websites, so always changing, always something new out there. I lead a team of developers, and it can be a lot. So there's a lot of balance needed between all the stuff I have to do at work and then all the stuff I have to do as a writer. So time management is very essential to my life. So between the coding, the meetings, and the organization of work life, and then you've got the writing, the marketing, the social media on the writing side. So, working these two jobs can be a lot, but I think they do lend well to each other because I do have kind of the both worlds on each side with the introvert and extroversion. So, I have coding time, which is very focused, just like writing time. And then you've got the meetings and the meeting with the business side, the same as doing the social media and doing the marketing as a writer. So they kind of offset.
Joanna, thank you for appearing on Apollo Papyrus. You were an amazing guest.
Thank you so much. I had a lot of fun. Thank you.
I wish Joanna well with the Lumos Gems Chronicles. This is Aaron Apollo Camp reminding y'all to write and read your passion. Bye for now. Remember to subscribe to the Apollo Papyrus YouTube channel at www.youtube.com/@ApolloPapyrus and the Apollo Papyrus Substack newsletter at apollopapyrus.substack.com. Y'all can visit the Apollo Papyrus website at campaaronapollo.witsite.com/ApolloPapyrus and follow Apollo Papyrus on Threads, Instagram, Facebook, and Tumblr at Apollo Papyrus. Copyright 2024 Aaron Apollo Camp, all rights reserved. This podcast episode is intended for the private listening of our audience. Any reuse or retransmission of this episode without the express written consent of the podcast host is prohibited, except under fair use guidelines. Royalty-free music and sound effects obtained from https://www.zapsplat.com.